and not feel embarrassed that I messed it up, so I'm glad to do that again today. Tomorrow is Korean Independence Movement Day. I don't know exactly what that means. I think it was a movement before the actual independence. But anyway, it's a Korean holiday, so maybe there's a lot of people celebrating that this weekend, and they're not here today. So I know that our school has it off, and we're excited for the long weekend. So we're down in numbers from what was last week, but hopefully people will be coming back next week. So maybe if you're out on vacation and you weren't able to be here, you can watch the live stream and be a part of our worship service this morning. We're excited to be here again today. Ladies, I believe it's your week to do Bible study, meet together. I think you're doing virtual meetings and continuing to encourage each other until more restrictions are lifted. So we're excited that y'all can encourage each other. Just continue to work with each other and pray for each other throughout the week, and just be in contact, just building each other up and looking for opportunities to share. That's always a challenge in this time right now, where we feel like we need to isolate ourselves for safety. It feels like a challenge to know how to share God's love with others around us. So just be praying to God. He'll give you those opportunities. We're going to start our worship with some songs that we usually do. So will you go ahead and stand with me, and we'll begin our worship.
Worship you. You are way made.
Father. Second week in a row, and just keep praying that those numbers go down for COVID. What do we have to pray about this morning? Lift up to God and request and thanksgiving. Hard to hear, like arthritis pain? Alright, let's come before the Lord in prayer. Dear Heavenly Father, I thank you that we can come before you, Lord. We thank you for your Son, Jesus, who died on the cross for our sins so that we can come to you boldly, Lord, and kneel before your throne, Lord. Lord, I'm sure there's a lot of things going on in our church family, and request that we didn't speak out loud this morning, Lord, that we just lay before you, Lord. We lay our aches and pains, Lord, and arthritis and these things, Lord, they're all under your control, Lord. If it be your will, Lord, we just ask that you would relieve those pains and that you would bring healing, Lord, physical healing, Lord, and also just healing for our souls, Lord. Lord, we pray for all those listening today and here with us this morning physically that your word would be clear, that it would speak to our hearts, Lord, that it would bring the necessary changes, Lord, so that we can be more like you and be a light to our world, Lord, and love as you called us to love. Pray for Jacob this morning, Lord. May his words be clear, and may the Holy Spirit speak truth through him. In Jesus' name we pray, amen.
There are a lot of memes, right? I'm sorry. Mimes. That's not a thing. Some people call them memes. That's not a thing. There are a lot of memes. Yeah, about 2020. I don't know if you've seen these. I actually looked at some this week because I was thinking about how frequently we think about this past year and even so far this year as like really, really bad. And so when you just type in, if you just type in 2020 and these memes and see what comes up, the first thing is this man dragging this plastic bag, this trash bag, that has 2020 on it, and then dumping it in the trash can. Of course, the meme repeats, so it's just over and over. We want to be done with it to the next one is of the whole dumpster that says 2020, and it's on fire. And then if you look further, there's another one of a dumpster, and it says 2020 on it, and it's on fire, and it's in a river that's flooded and it's flowing down the river. And it's like, okay, I think we get it. Like, people really think 2020 was a really bad thing. There's another one, it says on the top, going through 2020 like. And it has this man, big man, going down a slide. Like, and it has the several different bumps on it. And he's like going and he flies in the air and he turns sideways and bumps. And then he turns sideways again and bumps. And he eventually gets to the end, but he's all bumped and banged up. Another one says, thank God it's over, 2020. Thank God it's over. And then the next one says, December 32nd, 2020. So if you're calculating, it's December 90th of 2020. We're not done with 2020 yet. There are a lot of people that are still trying to figure out what in the world happened last year and how it's still happening, like even for this year. It seems like, in Psalm 46, what we just read, it seems like the whole earth has been trembling, and then there's like a mountain that's been thrown into the heart of sea, and everybody's freaking out. One Christmas ornament from 2020 says 2020. Actually, I have a picture here. We're going to be talking about thinking like Christ. Not like this, but there's this ornament of the Grinch, and he's holding it. And he says, stink, stink, stunk. Like, this year just, it's terrible. It just stinks like sweet, let's throw it away. It's like COVID stole Christmas, not the Grinch. But we laugh about that. And it's good to have humor. We have to have humor. But I want to bring it up because it's just a given, right? That we would just believe that, and we would want to like be done with these bad things or these hard times, and just like let's go back to the way it was before. The rest of the world would look at last year and so far this year and look like it was the worst ever. But that is not the way that Christians think. Christians have a different perspective on it because we have hope. We look at the world and what's going on, and we're able, by faith, we're able to look beyond the temporary physical time and to see that God is doing something more. God is doing something bigger. And we look beyond that because we have hope. And this is why all throughout the centuries, including in the New Testament, that Christians are able to sing in prison. And they're in their prison cell, even in chains, and Christians are able to sing. Why is that? Because they have hope. If you didn't know that God was going to turn all of this His way, then you couldn't sing in prison. If you didn't believe that God was going to use this for good, even for your good, making you to become more like Christ, which is a bigger and better goal, a better thing than just getting out of these temporary, this suffering, then you couldn't sing. If you didn't believe that, you couldn't sing. How could you rejoice during trials if you didn't know that in the end, truth wins? Because we know, as Christians, we know that truth wins in the end. Now, depending on the perspective that you have, so I put this picture up. I just think this is really cute. This little baby. And she has these glasses on. And it's like, I just picture that, you know, like we think of glasses as a perspective or as a way of viewing the world, maybe an attitude, maybe a way of thinking. And so there's two different kinds of glasses that we can choose to put on. The first kind is not the kind that she has on. She has the good kind on, I'm pretty sure. But the first kind of glasses is this worldly kind of glasses, and you wear this, and the way you look at the world is, And so you get depressed, you get angry, you get you kind of mope around, and you complain. Or you wear godly glasses looking at the same exact thing. It's not different. The circumstance is the same. We all live in the same broken, fallen world, but you wear these glasses that are the thinking of Christ, and instead of being depressed and getting angry and moping around and complaining, now we're rejoicing, and we're waiting with this expectant hope, and we dance and we sing. Now, I don't know about you, but I want to have that kind of glasses on. It's not just because I want to ignore reality, but because that is reality. Now, Paul had this kind of thinking. He had this kind of perspective. When he wrote the book of Philippians, this letter, he's writing from prison, and he's telling the people that he's writing to that are not in prison, he's telling them to rejoice, not because they're not in prison. He's rejoicing, and he's telling them, you guys got to rejoice too. And it's like, we want to stop Paul and even Peter, because he's talking about suffering and rejoicing as well. But Paul is, we want to stop and say, time out, Paul, you're in prison. Did you forget that? Aren't you like seeing the same reality that I'm seeing? You're supposed to be crushed and weeping, Paul. Why are you singing and rejoicing? But Paul doesn't stop there. He says, rejoice. And again I say rejoice. Paul has these glasses. He has this way of thinking that's different from everybody else, but it's the right kind of thinking. Where everybody else says, stink, stank, stunk. Paul says, praise God. Philippians 2:5 says, have this same mind, same attitude, maybe you could say the same glasses, as that of Jesus Christ. And it talks about how Jesus went to the cross willingly, obeying his heavenly Father, and that through that suffering, of willing suffering, God exalted him above every other name. And now everybody will call Jesus Lord. He had this perspective. Jesus had this thinking that we also, as Christians, are to have. We say, Paul, you know, you're in this prison cell. You shouldn't be rejoicing. And Paul says, no, actually, I'm thinking like Jesus thought. See, Jesus had this perspective. He had these glasses on that were right, and you have these wrong glasses on. You need to take those old worldly glasses off and put on the new godly glasses. You need to look at the world through the perspective that God wants you to see it through. And so then you put them on, and it's like, wow, this is an incredible opportunity. Here you are in prison, suffering. Wow, this is an incredible opportunity that God has given me. Maybe you say, oh, I've always wanted to be a missionary, and now I'm in prison. This is my mission field. It's a different perspective. It's totally different from the way of the world. We need to learn to think like Christ. And I don't know exactly about you and how you think. But I know for me, I don't think the way that Christ thinks often. I need to think more like Christ, to have that same way of thinking as him. And that's what we're going to be talking about today. And before we get into our passage in 1 Peter chapter 4, let's pray and ask the Lord to help us. Heavenly Father, God, we are so prone to look at the world today, either in general or specifically like in our homes and our families, and just say, oh, this is awful. But Lord, change our thinking. Help us to think, to have the way of thinking that Christ had. Help us to see life through faith, through the glasses of faith. And I pray, Lord, that this morning as we look into your word, that you would speak. You would speak through your word, and you would change our thinking, Lord. Use your word to teach us, to convict us, to show us how you want us to think. And Lord, would you change us so that really happens? We pray in Jesus' name. Amen. Okay, so we're in 1 Peter chapter 4, and if you didn't know this, we have in the bulletin here, so an outline for you to follow along. So let's look at verse 1. Peter's continuing this talk, this in his letter, about suffering and about how Christ suffered. And now he says, since therefore Christ suffered in the flesh, arm yourselves with the same way of thinking. Put those glasses on. Okay? Now, what is that way of thinking that Christ had? What was it? Jesus was convinced. It's like he knew that it was better for him to do right, to do the will of God, including to suffer and even to die. It was better for him. It was better overall than for him to just kind of go through life safely. Kind of go through life and do his own thing and try not to suffer. It was better for him to do the will of God. And so he did that. So we have to think this way. It's not like we're looking for suffering. That's not what he's talking about. We ought to be just as convinced to believe that God's way is better regardless of the immediate physical consequences, because we're looking beyond those things to see something that is yet to be seen in the future. So as we look at this passage and as we focus on this today and the way of thinking, I want you to consider, what is the thinking of Christ? Because that's our goal. We want to think the way that Jesus thought. What is the way that Jesus thought? We want to understand that. And we want to understand what the result of it is. Notice, though, that he says here in verse 1, arm yourselves with this way of thinking. Arm yourselves. And that stood out to me. Why would he say arm yourselves? Think, well, when you arm yourself, I'm thinking about Johnny. Like he's got to be, you know, when you play this stuff, right, Johnny, you have maybe a shield, you pretend like you're in battle, and you got to arm yourself with something to protect yourself, or else you're gonna get hurt in the battle. And it's the same thing. If we don't have this way of thinking, the way of thinking of Christ, then we're in danger. We're not safe. We're not armed. We're not ready. Armed and ready to what? To fight in the battle. We're in a battle. And we forget that sometimes. The way that Jesus thought was the safe way of thinking. It was protected thinking. Because what? If he didn't think that way, if we don't think that way, we're in danger. What are we in danger of? Following God's way leads to life. Following not God's way leads to suffering and death. In an ultimate way. In a bigger way. For us to choose that right here, right now, because we think that not doing God's way will help us to get pleasure or comfort or not suffer in this life, or something is better than God's way, that path leads to destruction. It's dangerous thinking. So we need to arm ourselves to be protected, to have this kind of thinking the way that Christ thought. So if we're to think like him, how did he think? What was Jesus' perspective? What glasses did he wear? We're going to continue in 1 Peter 4. But I want you to look at this passage in Hebrews as well. To get this perspective of what Jesus was thinking when he even went to the cross. And this is right after Hebrews chapter 11, the great chapter of all these people who had faith. All those people, they had these glasses on. Okay, they had this way of thinking on as well. And then it says, Hebrews 12:1. Therefore, since we are surrounded by so great a cloud of witnesses, all these people that went before us, that they had this way of thinking like Christ, before Christ even came in the flesh, let us also lay aside every weight and sin which clings so closely, and let us run with endurance the race that is set before us, looking to Jesus, the founder and perfecter of our faith. And listen to this, who for the joy set before him endured the cross. What was the way of thinking that Jesus had? Wow, suffering on the cross is awesome. No. God has a purpose in this. This is God's way. That at the end of this, there's going to be joy. There's going to be a resurrection. And it's not just for the joy set before him endured the cross, despising the shame, and is seated at the right hand of the throne of God. Consider him. Consider Jesus. Consider his way of thinking, who endured from sinners such hostility against himself. Why? Why should we consider? Why should we think this way? So that you may not grow weary and or faint-hearted. In your struggle against sin, you have not yet resisted to the point of shedding blood. And the implication is, you ought to resist even to the point of shedding blood and beyond. Why? Because this way of thinking, it's better to do the will of God and to suffer than to not do God's will, period. But we as believers, even now, a lot of times we look around at what's going on in the world and the church, and we grow weary, and we grow faint-hearted. Why is that? Because we're not considering Christ. We're not keeping our eyes looking to Jesus. Sometimes we resist temptation half-heartedly, as though we think, you know, it's a good thing. I mean, I know I'm supposed to say no to sin, but maybe it's not worth the feeling of resisting. Maybe it's not worth it to love when I don't feel like it. Maybe it's not worth it to do God's will. But we're not considering him who endured. Consider the thoughts that he had. Jesus endured the cross because of his love for God, his love for us. We ought to consider that and follow in his footsteps. Now, we look at the world sometimes and we think, you know what, God must be taking a vacation. He must be sleeping. Because if he is good and he's loving it and he's powerful and he's here and he knows what's happening, then the world would be different. No. No, you need to put on different glasses. God is doing exactly the way that he has planned it out. It's not a mistake. It's not a surprise to him. He knows what he's doing. And this is exactly what he's planned. Now, I'm going to go back to verse 2. Oops. Okay, so back to verse 1. He's saying, think the way that Christ thinks. We ought to have the same way of thinking, so that whoever has suffered in the flesh has ceased from sin. That's the end of verse 1. Whoever suffered in the flesh has ceased from sin. Now, I have a question. As we should ask questions when we read Scripture, what does he mean here? If you suffer in the flesh, then if you obey God and you suffer for that, then that means you'll never sin again? Well, we have to compare Scripture with Scripture. We know from other Scripture that's not right, because you have to look in the context as well. 1 Peter 3:17 says, "For it is better to suffer for doing good, if that should be God's will, then for doing evil." So he's talking about those suffering for doing what is right, not just suffering in general. But even then, it doesn't mean that a person would no longer sin at all because they have chosen to follow God's will at this time. But it means that those who have suffered in the flesh have ceased from sin, meaning they've acted in a way that's shown that obeying God rather than avoiding hardship is the most important motivation for his actions. No, so we know he's not saying you never sin. If you look at James 3:2, it says, "For we all stumble in many ways." 1 John 1:8 says, "If we say we have no sin, we deceive ourselves, and the truth is not in us." So don't believe that, okay, if I do right and then I suffer, then all of a sudden, like, I'm not going to struggle with sin anymore. Or that I'm going to be perfect. One commentator, Grudem, says it means that we ought to be committed to thinking and a pattern of action where obedience is even more important than our desire to avoid pain. And when we do that, then in that time, we have chosen not to sin because we're doing God's will. So let's continue on. So as to live the rest of the time in the flesh, as long as we're in this lifetime, we don't no longer live for human passions, but for what? For the will of God. For the time that is past suffices. It's enough for doing what the Gentiles want to do, living in sensuality and passions, drunkenness, orgies, drinking parties, and lawless idolatry. So, thinking like Christ. We're seeking to think like Christ. When we do that, when we put on those glasses, that way of thinking, that doing God's will is better than not, regardless of what may happen to us, it's better. And there's going to be joy looking beyond that to what is to come. We're looking to that future. When we think like Christ, it overcomes human passions, that temptation to do evil, and instead, we do the will of God. It overcomes passions to do the will of God. Now, some believers think, well, you know, it would be nice just to indulge one more time in unrestrained sin. One more time of doing what the Gentiles like to do, what unbelievers like to do, those outside of God's family like to do. Peter says, no, the time that is past is enough. You don't need it anymore. And in fact, if you haven't indulged in your flesh in that way, it's not worth it. Don't. Put on the way of thinking of Jesus. So he lists here a couple of things in verse 3 of sensuality. He's talking about living in regard with no moral restraint. Oftentimes this is talking about sexual immorality or also acts of physical violence. And that time it is done. No longer live that way. He says passions, sinful human desires that have a strong influence on our behavior. And then you can kind of group drunkenness and orgies and drunken parties together in this way, that a characteristic of life that's bent on following physical desires. Lawless acts of idol worship. And he doesn't explain about all of these things, but he says all of that is in the past. There's something better. See, the way that Christ views the world, the way that Jesus thinks, is those things are atrocious. Those things are terrible, and it's destruction. There's something so much better. All those things you used to do, but now your thinking is like Christ. So by faith, you do something good, even if there are bad consequences to that, because you look beyond just the here and now. Now, what happens when we live this way? When we choose to think like Christ, and we do what is right, and we resist temptation, and we say no to those who would say, hey, come and sit with us, or do this with us, or why aren't you? When we say no, what happens? Verse 4, with respect to this, they, that is, those the unbelievers who are doing these things, they are surprised when you, Christian, do not join them in the same flood of debauchery, and they malign you. But they will give account to him who is ready to judge the living and the dead. So the picture of what the people are doing is that they're running, they're rushing headlong toward destruction, this flood of debauchery. And these unbelievers are surprised that you don't join them. But it's not just a surprise, but now that they get upset about it. It's more than surprise. Now they turn hostile and they malign you. Why? Well, when we don't join someone in sin, we are a witness against that thing. We're a witness against it. Even if we're not adamantly saying, no, hey, this is wrong, and saying, God's going to judge you for that. Even if we're not speaking with our words, which we ought to speak with love as we speak the truth, with gentleness and mercy, but even a silent non-participation in sin implies condemnation of it. And people don't like to be called out of their sin. And so, you remember John the Baptist? John the Baptist, he called out Herod because Herod was living with his brother's wife. And John said, that's wrong. And so what happened to John? he was in prison. And then later, of course, Herod's brother's wife didn't like that either, and John was beheaded. But Herod will be judged. They will be judged for that. Those who malign or persecute believers will be judged. And it's not just for the living, but for those who have died as well. That means that death is not will not enable anyone to escape God's judgment. Just because someone died doesn't mean that they're off the hook now. Now, it's important to note, those people who practice these evil things and abuse Christians for failing to join them, they may seem at this time, with the worldly glasses, it looks like they're winning. It looks like they have a better life. If you have that kind of thinking and you think those people have a better life because, change your way of thinking to that of Christ. Look beyond that with the eyes of faith to know that there's a time coming when the world as we know it will end. And there will be judgment. He goes on to say in verse 6, for this is why the gospel was preached, even to those who are dead, that though judged in the flesh, the way people are, they might live in the spirit the way God does. Now this is a verse that there are a number of different interpretations about. But I'm not going to get into all the details here. But I believe that what he's saying is that for this is why the gospel was preached, even to those who are dead. Meaning, the gospel was preached to those when they were living. The gospel was preached to them, but now they're dead. Okay? And they were living when the gospel was preached to them. And they believed. And so now, even though they're dead, now they're living. There's life in the spirit, even after the physical body is dead. Because now that they're living in God. Luke chapter 20, verse 38 says, God is not the God of the dead, but of the living, for all live to him. So even after this physical death, there is still life. Our soul is still conscious. We still have a consciousness after death. And for those who believe in their lifetime, live to God even after death. Now, on top of this,
yes,
thinking like Christ, that means we overcome the temptation and the human passions to do the will of God. Why? Because we know that there's judgment. We know that there's something coming after this. And we believe, it's by faith, we believe that it's better, it's far better to follow God's way now than to disobey him and to have some little bit of pleasure now. Now, what else? Thinking like Christ also overcomes selfishness to serve the people of God. Verse 7 says, the end of all things is at hand. Therefore, be self-controlled and sober-minded for the sake of your prayers. Above all, keep loving one another earnestly, since love covers a multitude of sins. Show hospitality to one another without grumbling. And he goes on, and he's going to talk more about serving. But here, he's saying again, the end of all things is at hand. You know, so judgment can come at any time. We can't count on that being like 100 years from now. It could come today. So live today as though it could be any moment. The end of things, all things is at hand. All the major events in God's plan of redemption have occurred. And now all things are ready for Christ to return and to reign. All things are ready. So Christians who realize that, we're thinking this way. We're thinking about that happening. We remember God's love for us now. We remember God's love for us to die on the cross for our sins and to rise from the dead and to give us that promise that we also will rise with him. We live a certain way then because we have that thinking in mind. What does that look like? Well, he says in verse 7 about prayer, being self-controlled and sober-minded. The way that we ought to pray is not just like, okay, God, you know, thanks for our day and help us have a nice time. I'm guilty of that often. The way that we pray ought to be serious-minded. It shouldn't be flippant. We should view situations that we face maturely as we pray about them. Thinking the way of Christ. Christ often went away to pray. And even in the garden, you know, he wasn't like, oh yay, I get to go suffer now. He prayed earnestly. Seeking the will of God, not even his own. When we pray, we going to give you a stone when you ask for bread. And so we have to believe that when we come to him. And he goes on in verse 8, and he says, above all, keep loving one another. And it's not just a, okay, I guess I love you. But it's keep loving each other earnestly. It's our earnest, genuine, real love that's not half-hearted. It's not faint-hearted. It's earnest. Now, he says this above all, so we need to really pay attention to that. Some people think, well, it's not fair for God to tell us, for God to command us to love, because, I can't just, work up in myself these feelings of affection for somebody. I can't do that. Well, that's not what he's talking about. Because love is a choice. It's a decision to put the other person first. It's a decision. It's not about the feeling. So primarily, it's this thinking of Christ through the glasses of faith. It's not a feeling that you fall into. It's a mindset of putting the other person first. Jesus, I'm sure, and based on his prayer that we have in the Garden of Gethsemane, Jesus didn't want to. He didn't feel like going to the cross. But he wanted to do the will of God. And so his desire to do the will of God overcame his desire not to suffer in the flesh. Why? Because he had a love. He chose to go to the cross because of his love. Not, and this is important, it's not because we're good people. It's not because we deserve God's love. That's why Jesus suffered and died for us. No. We did not deserve God's love. Jesus took the wrath of God for us because God had anger against our sin. But he loved us. And so he made the only way for us to be saved. Love seeks the good of the other person, whether they deserve it or not. And oftentimes they don't. But neither do we. And unless we understand, I don't deserve the love of God, but he gives it anyway, then we will not be able to look at the other person who doesn't deserve our love and give it anyways. We have to receive God's love, understanding we don't deserve it, so then we'll be able to give love even if the other person doesn't deserve it. That's the kind of thinking that God wants us to have, because that's how he treated us. We have to treat others the same way. So where this doesn't happen in churches for Christians, when we don't love one another earnestly, there's a lot of bad things that happen. Love, when love is lacking, every word that someone says is viewed with suspicion. Every action is liable to misunderstanding and to condemnation from one another. There's assumptions and there's pointing the fingers. And these conflicts abound. And Satan loves that. Satan loves it. What does it look like when we do? When Christians really love one another, small offenses, and even sometimes bigger, larger ones, when somebody sins against us, it's overlooked. It's overlooked. It's forgotten. God's love is bigger than that. Therefore, our love ought to be bigger than that. Now, does that mean that we just ignore every sin and offense? No. We ought to speak the truth in love. We ought to confront with gentleness. That doesn't mean we're okay with just everybody sinning and not talking about that so that we would grow. God deals with our sin, but he still loves us. It's in love. It means that we have a willingness to treat people according to God's mercy rather than according to their sin. Okay. He goes on to say hospitality. This is one way that we can love one another. Hospitality without grumbling. And I find that interesting because this is a way of thinking. One way that believers show active love is by caring for someone in our home, feeding them, hosting them, housing them if they need a place to sit to sleep, not complaining about the expense that's involved or the preparation that's involved or the sacrifice that's involved, giving up my time for somebody else, and all of those things that we often complain about. No. Jesus didn't have that thinking. He was like, well, I guess I have to come to earth. No. It was in love. It was a choice of love, and it wasn't with complaining. Why? Because it's far better. is he had this thinking that he was always looking to the will of God, and it surpassed any suffering, anything that he might have to give up that he might desire in this body. It's worth it. It's worth giving up of myself. And he continues on. This love that we have, what does it look like to have the thinking of Christ? We overcome selfishness to serve one another. He says in verse 10, as each has received the gift, because all of us have received the gift from God as believers, the Spirit of God is living inside of us, and he's gifted us, not for ourselves, but to serve. So he says, use it. You received the gift from God. Use it to serve one another as good stewards of God's varied grace. Not all your gifts are the same, but you're a steward of that gift. It's not your gift. It's God's gift that he's letting you borrow. You're a steward of it. You have it. It's not yours. He's the Lord. He owns you. And so you do with what he's given you for this time being for him to serve one another. So verse 11, what does it look like when whoever speaks? As one speaks the oracles of God, whoever serves, as one who serves by the strength that God supplies, in order that in everything God may be glorified through Jesus Christ. To him belong glory and dominion forever and ever. Amen. So verse 8 again, he says, earnestly love one another. And this finds expression in hospitality and other and in spiritual gifts. It's not for self-advancement. It's not for me. It's not to point to me or to draw attention to ourselves. It's for the benefit of others. So Peter says, you received a gift, use it to serve one another. We take it to mean that in the same way that somebody has received the gift, use it to help it, to benefit the other person. How did you receive the gift then? Use it in the same way as you received it. How did you receive the gift? Did you earn it? Did you work for it? No, it was free. You received it freely, out of grace, not out of a merit, something that you worked so that God gave you this. No, it's a free gift. So, use it. How? Well, you don't deserve it. Well, you didn't work for it. No. Use it freely. It doesn't matter whether the other person deserves it or not. That's not the point. The point is the will of God. God's given this to you freely, so freely give it. Sometimes we think, what if I use my gift for others? If I serve others and if I give up on myself and love them and pour out all of myself for them, then I'm not going to have anything left. I'm going to be used up and wasted and tired and burnt out. Is that what this passage says? No. No. God's rule for our gifts is that as we use them freely, as we receive them, we use them freely. With the confidence, we use them with the confidence that God will replenish what is needed because he's faithful. As we faithfully use them, he will replenish them. Verse 11. Serve how? By the strength that God supplies. So as we serve, there's this thinking. It's not about me. It's about the will of God because he's done all of this for me. I will freely do this. Not holding against anybody. Not holding back because, oh, I'm not going to have enough anymore. That doesn't mean we don't take care of our bodies or something like that. But using what God's given freely for the benefit of the other person, God's strength is what enables us to do that. It's not our own strength and ability. Now, there is a way to serve in such a way that it does make it about you and you're using your own strength to do it, and then you're not, you really do feel burnt out. And that's because you're not really believing that God loves you unconditionally. That you can trust him. And he's given you everything that you need. He's given you mercy without your merit. You don't have to perform. It's not a performance. Serving other Christians is not about being a good Christian. It's about receiving God's service for us and just passing it on. You say, oh, I can't give what I don't have. Exactly. Christianity is more about receiving than giving, because we've received infinite amount from God already. And if you don't think that, then there's this blockage. You're not really abiding. Receive what God has given. His infinite love. His mercy. You don't deserve it. You didn't earn it. You can't do anything to get it. You just believe. And he gives it to you. And then you have infinite amount to give. It's crazy. Because it's not your strength. It's Jesus's. Now, he says here with speaking gifts. Those who speak ought to speak as speaking the oracles of God. Like speaking the things of God. Which is it's a very high calling. But when he says speaking gifts, I think he's talking about all kinds of speaking things. Evangelism, sharing the gospel, right? Teaching, preaching the word of God, encouraging one another, exhorting one another. Confrontation is a way of speaking as well. Even through singing, we teach one another through singing, through sharing words of praise and of testimony. So if somebody speak as though they're speaking the words of God. Now that doesn't mean we should claim that the words that I'm speaking is exactly what God would say. Or as though this is the very words of God, because that would be like, oh, this needs to go into the Bible on top of what God's already said. That's not what he's saying. It means we have to speak with the seriousness of purpose which one should use if we were speaking the words of God. If God were speaking, if Jesus were speaking, this is what we believe that he would be saying. And it's with that seriousness. The end result of serving one another and of speaking to one another and of giving what God has given to us is that while we're depending on God to do that, God is glorified. That's the end goal. That's the most important thing. That's the thinking that Jesus had. So the focus and attention and praise shifts from us and goes to God. And that's the goal. One last thing. When we think like Jesus, thinking like Jesus, it overcomes human passions to instead do the will of God. It overcomes selfishness to instead serve. And it also overcomes the world to glorify God. 1 John 5, 4 and 5 says, "For everyone who has been born of God overcomes the world." And this is the victory that has overcome the world, our faith. Who is it that has overcome the world? Who is it that overcomes the world except the one who believes that Jesus is the Son of God? This is the way of thinking. What is the thinking that Christ had? What are the glasses that he wore? It was that of faith. Looking beyond these temporary circumstances and suffering to the glory of God. Doing the will of God because he loves us. So I just ask you, in your own heart, in your own mind, like, do you want to be an overcomer? Like, do you want to rise above the misery and the complaining and the disheartened worldly kind of thinking? The only way to do that is by believing what God has said. That's the glasses. That's this kind of glasses that you put it on, it's like, wow, what an opportunity. The world looks at this thing, stink, stank, stunk, and you look at it, what an opportunity. What is God doing? I can't wait to see what he does. God is so good. He's given me this opportunity to serve him in the midst of all this craziness when everybody's wondering what's happening and they're going crazy. And I have peace because God is with me. Maybe you don't have that perspective. Maybe you don't have that kind of thinking. And you're tempted with the pleasures of this life and you're not sure if you can give up of yourself to serve and you're struggling with that. Again, the only way to have that kind of thinking is to look to Jesus by faith and receive what he's done for you by believing that he is the one that God promised to send into the world to save us, that he died on the cross for our sins, that he rose from the dead, that he is Lord, that he is returning again, that one day there is going to be judgment, but that judgment has already gone for us. It's gone on Christ. He's taken the wrath of God on himself, and now we're free. Now we're free from that old way of life. Now we can live for God, but it's not about us working it up in ourselves to do it. God living through us. That's the gospel. And it's so awesome what God has done. I pray that for each one of us, we would wear that same way of thinking, of those glasses, that way of looking at life, God's perspective, so that whenever, whatever happens in our family, in our church, in our workplaces, in the whole world, when everything else might seem like it's upside down, like it's backwards, like it's terrible, like it's awful, we could look at this and see, wow, God is doing something. He's doing a work here. I don't understand all of it, but I know that God is working these things out for good. It's the perspective of faith. It's the perspective that our Savior had, and we ought to have the same thinking. Let's pray. Lord Jesus, I pray for each one hearing your word this morning, that if any of them have not accepted that gift that you freely give, that gift of eternal life and of forgiveness, that today they would believe. And you've given your only son, that you've given up of your life for them, that you're alive, that you're coming again, that you're offering forgiveness and open arms to them. And I pray that they would receive your mercy and grace that you so freely offer. Lord, I thank you for your love. I pray that you'd help us to understand your love in a bigger way, so that we also would love well, love earnestly even. Lord, we don't deserve it, and those that you're telling us to love also don't deserve it. Father, help us to continually look to Christ and the love that he has for us, so that we would be able to give it to people that don't deserve it as well. Lord, give us a higher perspective. Give us the thinking of Christ. Increase our faith, Lord. And we pray that you would be glorified in all of it. We pray in Jesus' name.
Going to continue our worship service with taking up an offering. So if there's something God put in your heart to give this morning, you can do that as the offering's passing around. We're going to sing together.
Heavenly Father, since Christ suffered in the flesh for us, I pray that for each one here, we would arm ourselves with the same way of thinking, so that we would live our lives no longer for human passions, but for the will of God. And that above all, Lord, I pray that we would keep loving one another earnestly. I pray that we would use the gifts that you've given us to serve one another, in order that in everything you may be glorified through Jesus Christ. To him belong glory and dominion forever and ever. Amen. Thank you, everyone. You are dismissed.